I have a very exciting word from the scriptures today. It's an autobiographical parenthesis from the Apostle Paul. It's written in the 15th chapter of his first letter to the Corinthians, and in it he opens his mind and heart to allow them to know him in the depth of his own being. Hear the reading of the Word of God. 1 Corinthians 15th chapter, beginning with the 8th verse. Paul has described the appearances of the resurrected Christ to the apostles and then to the birth and growth of the church. And then he says, "Then last of all he was seen by me as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. But I labor more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me." Let us pray. Blessed living Lord, touch us with the power of your Spirit. Set us free to be the kind of caring, serving, daring people you want us to be. There's a suffering, aching, troubled world all around us, longing to find out about you, Lord, and about how you love and forgive. Probably the only Bible many people will read, they'll read in us. Lord, touch us, that we may become communicators of your grace and faithful and obedient disciples where we live and work, through Christ our Lord. Amen. I have a very interesting card in my hand. It looks like a credit card, but it isn't. But I don't want you to leave home without it. It's called the hug card. And all you do is place your thumb on it for 10 seconds, and it will tell you how many hugs you need right now. Not bad, is it? For example, if it remains black, you need 4 hugs. If it turns red, you're not so bad off. You only need 2 hugs. If it's green, you can get by with 1 hug. And if it's blue, you're ready to hug somebody else. Now, we don't need a card like that to tell us that every one of us need to be embraced with love and affirmation and encouragement. But I want to suggest that there's one person from whom we need an embrace more than anyone else. Can you imagine who that person is? One person. And when that person embraces us, it sets us free. It's probably the person that finds it most difficult to hug us or embrace us just as we are. Have you ever found that sometimes you're reluctant to embrace someone, even someone you love, because of something he or she has done or said that's really just rankled inside of you? If you're judgmental and you say, "Listen, I'm not going to give that person an affirming hug. It'll just encourage them to go on doing and saying the things that he or she has already done. No affirmation for me," we say. I want to suggest that the one person from whom we all need an embrace of encouragement is ourselves. Ourselves, you say? How can you embrace yourself? Is that some kind of sloppy narcissism, the contemplation of yourself and your own needs? No, something much deeper than that. I wonder if I might have permission to share a very personal story. I believe we share an adventure together, and because of that, we also share the times that we're down and hurting and times when we're on the mountain peaks of victory. We share the adventure, and therefore we're vulnerable with each other. And that's where our freedom comes. I want to share with you a moving experience that took place in my life not too long ago. And it gave profound healing in my life. During the time that I was preparing for this series of the 12 steps on living without fear, I tried to take each one of the steps personally. I really believe that nothing can happen through us until it happens to us. And you can only communicate to another person what is fresh as a new experience in your own life. It's always true. And that law of the spirit world is as irrevocable as gravity is in the natural world. And so, as I studied each of the steps to living without fear, the ones we've talked about in previous weeks, I tried to be sure that I'd taken each one of those steps myself. I couldn't tell you about it or try and encourage you to take those steps unless I had done it myself. But when I came to the sixth step, I just have to tell you, it was a very difficult thing for me to do. The sixth step is, I will accept and affirm myself as loved and accepted by God. Now, the reason that I felt that was so important was because over 30-some years of ministry, I'd observed that most of us project to the world around us the fears from inside. We see in other people the threat that we feel inside. What we project with transference into the situations and circumstances of our life is nothing other than what's going on inside. And so I knew that the crucial sixth step in living without fear was to experience love for ourselves. Well, I knew that John had put it very clearly. Perfect love casts out fear. And you remember that the Greek word for perfect is teleos, which means that which accomplishes its purpose. It also means mature, as we've studied it previously. So God's perfect love that accomplishes its end enables a mature love in us. And I think there's one last link in the experience of that teleos love in our lives. And that's what the Lord helped me to experience more deeply than ever before. I was all alone in my hotel room in Edinburgh, Scotland. I was praying through the steps, and I came to this step. And I knew I had to take it with a greater stride than I'd ever taken it before. And it happened. During the time of my quiet prayer, the Lord said, Lloyd, close your eyes and form on the screen of your mind's eye the image of yourself. Have you ever tried to do that? I hadn't. And I want to tell you, it took me a full hour to be able to form on my mind's eye the image of Lloyd. And once I did, then the Lord gave me a second instruction. He said, go and embrace Lloyd. I said, listen, Lord, you can give me lots of things to do, but the one person I know more about than anyone in the world is Lloyd, and he's not worthy of my hug right now. I thought back of all of the stupid, dumb, inadequate things I'd done in my lifetime. And even after becoming a Christian, I could make a long list of the things I wish I'd never done and the things I wish I had done. I said, listen, Lord, I can hug the world and embrace them with affirmation and preach the gospel and reach out and care and ache and hope and dream, allow my heart to be broken for everybody, but don't ask me to do it for Lloyd. He said, go and embrace Lloyd. And by his grace, I was finally able to do it. And I want to tell you, deep inside of me, I felt love and peace and joy beyond anything that I had ever experienced up to this point. But more than that, I felt a more courageous love for people and a desire to be more daring for him than ever before. Suddenly, the things that had caused me fear, that held me back, constricted, were gone. Don't you see, deep down inside, the perfect love of God must cast out our fears so that we can get moving with him in caring for people and ministry where people suffer. But he's got to do something inside. He's created us in such a way that he's elected us to be priests to ourselves as well as to others. And that's what he had called me to do, was to take his perfect love and allow it to accomplish its end, its telos, in me. Now, in case you think that that's just my personal experience and isn't biblical, look into that 15th chapter of Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. He soars with the sheer delight of the resiliency of the resurrection. He can't contain himself because he knows four basic things. The pre-existent Christ lived and walked and preached and taught in Jesus of Nazareth. In him, the strategy of God, the kingdom of God, had been imparted. For the sins of the world, he'd gone to a cross. And then by the power of God, he was raised up and was ubiquitous in the world, but had chosen to make his post-resurrection home in the minds and hearts of believers. And then as Paul describes the way the Lord appeared, first to Cephas, to Peter, and then to the larger band of the apostles, and then to James, he finally has to stop and say, listen, he appeared to me. And then he uses a phrase which in the Greek reveals a whole lot more than the present translations reveal. It really says, and he appeared to me, one born with an abortion. Now, that indicates what people were saying about his new birth in Christ. They said, he's nothing but an abortion. He's not real. Paul had the onslaught of the Judaizers, the critics from within the church and outside of the church, and he was feeling it in his being, internalizing it. And then he said, it's all true. I don't have to defend myself. It's all true. I was one kind of an abortion in the way I was born into Christ. Came late, and I persecuted the church, and And yet, listen, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And then he begins to gather his forces and realizes that he has been given permission by Almighty God to love Paul. And that's what needs to happen to us. Three things. Catch the progression of the text. It's magnificent. It's excited me all week. I can hardly wait to tell you about it. First of all, an honest confession of what we've been and are tempted to become again apart from the grace of God. Great thing to be able to be honest and open with people and with life. You know, I used to live two lives, the one inside and the one on the outside, and I polished the outside in order so that nobody would ever know what was on the inside. I once had a good friend by the name of Bill Beaners who said, Lloyd, when you go into the pulpit, pull your collar. I used to wear a backward collar. He said, pull your collar off, leave your fly open, and stumble into the pulpit, split three infinitives in the first paragraph, and they'll hear what you've got to say. How stupid for me to think that I couldn't let the real person inside. But honest confession before God brings a kind of healing in our inner being that enables us to be relaxed, free people with a winsome love for others. Secondly, humble praise for what we've become by the grace of God. It's a wondrous experience to be free, to know that you're a never-to-be-repeated miracle of the living God. Can you say right now, but by the grace of God, I am what I am? You see, when you get to the place that you can give God the glory, then you can enjoy all of the wonderful things that he does in you and around you and through you. No false humility. Paul said to the Colossians, don't let anyone defraud you with false humility. Paul could point to God in everything. You know what? Sometimes I read a book I've written and I can't believe it. When I was a kid, English was one of my hardest subjects. There's no question in my mind that God does it. He does it through me, and I praise God for that. But it's his miracle, and I know it. No problem for me to take credit for that. I know it's his gift. Have you had the freedom to be able to look at yourself and all that God has done in you and through you, the serendipities of his grace, and be so filled with praise that you can hardly contain yourself? That's how to live as a free person, free of fear. Because you know that in everything, God will manifest himself for good, and there's nothing of which you need to be afraid. And you can let life go and live to the fullest, because everything is for his glory. But notice that after Paul said, and I am what I am by the grace of God, and the grace of God was not given to me in vain, then he could express an heroic kind of service to the needs of others. And quite honestly, he could say, and I ministered more abundantly than all the rest, but not I, but the grace of God. His mind's eye could go back over Achaia and Macedonia and Greece. And then he could think of all that was happening in the proconsul of Asia, the changed lives, the birth and growth and dynamic power of the church. And constantly he was pointing up, it's all to the glory of Christ. See, the reason we live such puny lives is because since we want to take all of the credit, we can't live beyond what we can give ourselves credit for. But when you can give God the credit, and he's the ruler and power of the universe, then there's no limit. and wonderful things begin to happen. We're the whole realm of nature mine. That were a promise far too small. Love most amazing, divine, demands my life, my soul, my all.